Welcome to the Public Voice Salon. My name is John Bredin. We are a progressive on-air dialogue on culture, politics, and the critical issues of our time. And we have the great pleasure today to be broadcasting from the home of one of the world's noted public intellectuals, Stanley Aronowitz, who is a distinguished professor of sociology at the CUNY Grad Center, longtime labor activist, starting out in Newark, New Jersey, where he was an organizer back in the 1960s. And he has so many accomplishments, author of over 25 books, one of the great organizers of our time and intellectuals. And we wanted to check in with Stanley and just let him speak a bit about the situation in the country, the political situation, and what are his thoughts on what's going on.
The most notable aspect of the political situation in our country, John, is that we now have seen two exactly opposite developments. One is that the Republican Party, which used to be one of the two umbrella parties of our country, the other one being obviously the Democratic Party, the Republican Party has become an ideological right-wing party. Its most distinguishing characteristic is that it has driven out all the moderates from the party. Even Mitt Romney, who wants to be president of the United States, is now forced to be a raving lunatic. Well, he is. I mean, and everybody says, well, you know, if he gets elected or during the campaign, he'll move again to the left or to the center. I'm not so sure that's probable at this point. But the other side of it is that young people are becoming activists again. And although they're not the only people in the Occupy Wall Street movement, they are the dominant group, and they have moved considerably to the left. So, but what we're seeing, therefore, is in many ways the activist communities of our country, that is to say, the people who take active interest in politics, fight for candidates, fight on issues, are becoming polarized. And what is true is that the moderates in both camps of the Democrats and Republicans, and to some extent the liberals in the Democratic camp, are not active anymore. They're not, or at least they're not at the cutting edge. Now, this is in the framework of a country which is becoming increasingly militarized. The militarization is not simply the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan or the threatening war in Iran against Iran, but it's also, and perhaps even more importantly, beginning to infect our major institutions, one of which is education. It's probable, in my view, that most public high schools, especially in the cities, not necessarily in the suburbs, but also in the suburbs to some extent, are becoming basically militarized camps. The cops are in every high school. The great achievement of the administration of any high school, that is to say the principal and the assistant principals, is to make sure that there's no disruption, that everything is quiet. And of course, the curriculum in those high schools has been militarized, and they call it standardized testing. And I think that's a militarization of the high schools. The elementary schools are less militarized because you can't do that with 6 and 7 or 8 year old kids. But there is a problem even there, which is that now they're subjecting 5, 6, 7, 8 year old kids to the same kind of rigorous academic standards that they do to young people who are in their teen age. And every developmental psychologist of any note, Vygotsky, Piaget, Jerome Bruner, says you should not really submit children to that kind of rigor until they're 8 or 9 years old. And we're doing this with 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 year old children. The other aspect of militarization, in New York City, for example, we have a police commissioner who has undertaken to stop every black or Latino man that they can get their hands on. They had 800 and some thousand stop and frisk incidents in 2011 800,000 and 860,000. Oh, that is a police force which is no longer really the protectors of the population. It's the attack against the population. But that's symptomatic of what's going on in other large cities. The main criterion for those police forces is that they keep the population down. And the population of many of the cities, Philadelphia, New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, are becoming increasingly Latino and black, and they are now subjected to a militarized police. There's a third major trend in our country, which is rather serious, which is that aside from the police function and the standardized function, there is a collapse of the social welfare state. It's virtually complete. The government, both the Obama government and the previous Bush government, have not been able to substantially reduce the amount of money in Social Security. But they're now talking about that Medicare has been overspent, that Medicaid has been overspent, and both the Democrats and Republicans are getting ready after the election, they won't do it before the election, to cut Medicare and Medicaid. We already have a 20% copay by people, so you have to buy extra insurance if you're on Medicare. A very good friend of mine is on Medicare, and she has to buy supplementary insurance in order to be able to cover hospital and doctor visits and so on. But I would suspect it'll go up to 30 or 35%, maybe even 40% after the election, no matter who's elected. So we're talking about a situation in our own country, as well as in Western Europe, where the money available for all kinds of basic services in the field of health, in the field of education, in the field of public safety, is really being substantially reduced, except for the police. So there we are.
Oh my goodness.
That's my short-term answer.
I want to show a copy of this book called Against Schooling, one of Stanley's recent books. It's called Against Schooling for an Education That Matters. And Claudia, if you could zoom in on that, and you could see the front cover where it shows you the standardized tests and penciling the bubble sheets. So the interesting thing about Stanley is not only are you a pointed political thinker, but you get very involved with education. You have a lot to say about education in terms you were actually an educational reformer yourself. In fact, I actually taught at the school that Stanley founded, called Park East High School in East Harlem. Stanley founded it in 1972 or early 70s. Yeah, by the time I got there, it had really fallen apart because Stanley had left. But in its heyday, it was one of the great progressive places. Stanley, do you think that in some way the educational crisis is connected to the political crisis? How you know, are they trying to dumb down the population, or?
I don't think anybody's trying to dumb down the population in intention, but I think the dumbing down has a lot to do with the ideology of education that has emerged. Really, since the 90s, this was true not only of Bush, but it was also true of the Clinton administration and many of the local administrations in the educational scene. The basic idea of the new educational ideology is that children should be prepared for jobs, that education has virtually nothing to do below the idea that people should be prepared for the workforce, that cultural life, that sports, that music, art,
critical thinking
are really subordinate to the idea that you should be prepared, that you should be schooled to order. That's a term that David Nasso, my colleague, coined when he wrote his book in the 70s. So, but now it's no longer a particular problem, it has now become the general problem. So that the idea that we should have an educated population in the genuine sense of people who could identify poetry, who know novels, who know music, who know art and painting, who have an acquaintanceship with museums. That idea has basically fallen by the wayside. And what's happened is that many of the curricula, both at the elementary and the secondary level, as well as at the college level, public universities, is now focused narrowly on science and mathematics, but not even the conceptual basis of science or the conceptual basis of mathematics, but simply the rote learning of those disciplines, to the sacrifice of English, to the sacrifice of history and of social sciences, and of even in the sciences a really critical understanding of what biology is about, of what evolution is about, what physics is about. So that's what's going on. I define myself, John, not as an educational reformer anymore. I don't think it's possible to reform education. Not the way we did 40 years ago. 40 years ago, there was a bit of experimenting because we had a recognition at the top, as well as at the bottom, that there was a crisis in education. That the crisis in education was not only that children were having trouble reading or trouble doing numeracy, but that, in effect, the society was at risk for the lack of an educated population. Now, the notion that we have a crisis in education, which is based on the reform of the schools, I think has fallen. I believe that we cannot really reform education, we have to radically transform it. And the radical transformation that I advocate, you will be surprised, is not a liberalization of education, but I've become an educational conservative. And I'll tell you what I mean by that. Well, I'll tell you what I mean. I believe in that children should learn the classics, that children should learn that high school students should be reading Dostoevsky, that high school students should be reading George Eliot, that high school students should be reading philosophy. We don't have
Thomas
philosophy.
Thomas Mann behind you there.
Thomas Mann, okay. That's correct. that high school students should really be prepared in the classics. And that should be, instead of at the college level, the basis of literary learning, that everybody ought to be learning history. I don't mean just history as, black history, I'm for that, or Latino history, or history of social movements, I'm also for learning that. But I believe that people should know the dates. I think that people should know that the American Revolution began in 1776, and was over by 1783, that they should know that the Civil War was between 1860 and 1865. I think people should know things like that. And I think the trouble is that that kind of history is no longer being taught. Thirdly, in the social science curriculum, that children do not really, and young adults do not really have a grasp of the fundamental reasons for why we have poverty, why we have social problems, why we have labor unrest upon occasion, why we have the Occupy Wall Street movement. That is to say, why young people are distressed and upset. They don't learn that in high school. High school has become a ritual performance of getting through so that you can qualify for college. And the college that people go to, community colleges and state colleges generally, are not colleges that, to a large extent, offer a real education either. Some of them do better than others, but obviously there is a problem. And the problem is that given the orientation of education for work, education for jobs, education for the workforce, that it is unlikely in the near future that we're going to have a genuine education movement at the top. So what you need is students, and especially their parents at the elementary and high school level, to begin to demand an enriched curriculum, a curriculum that really not trains, but genuinely educates for critical thinking. Yeah.
Well, Stanley, you know,
I am so grateful to have known you now the past 10 years. When we first met was at a Left Forum conference in 2002. At that time, you were running for Green Party governor of New York.
That's correct.
Okay. I've always been inspired by your activism and also by, you know, the inclusiveness of how you bring people in. You've recently created a kind of an informal university at the Breck Forum where you were having...
The process of doing
okay, yes. Okay, so I don't want want to talk about that before it's premature. But and just look around the apartment, Claudia. Take a look at some of the books. You know, extensive collection of books here. It just feels, you know, you could feel the intellectual spirit here. But talk a little bit, Stanley, about your own biography, because I think you're one of those people where your own subjectivity and your experiences in life have influenced your thinking and shaped your thoughts. So I was reading a little bit in Against Schooling you have in the introduction. You talk about you had a great uncle who was into, he had books on Kafka and Dostoevsky, and your own mother. She was very much wanted to pursue an education. Pan around the apartment, get some of the works of art.
That's
your mom's painting right there. Look at that. Oh, my goodness. So your mom, who was worked in a factory, but talk about your mom.
And wholesale places. She was not a factory worker. My grandparents were factory workers. Her aunt was a skilled garment worker. My grandfather was more than a skilled tailor. He was an expert master tailor. But they all were in unions. They all were active in the unions. And some of them, like one of my great uncles, not the same one that had all these books, but one of my great uncles was a founder of the Cloakmakers Union. That is to say, he was one of the early organizers of the Cloakmakers Union. And my grandfather was in the Cutters Union of the Amalgamated Clothing Workers, which was the men's clothing industry. And then he became a manager. So, you know, there was a lot of political as well as cultural background in these working class people. You know, this was not the same as today, where most working class people do not have that kind of cultural background. My mother was a painter. She died at the age of 97 in 2010. My mother was a painter, and she played the violin and was my first violin teacher. So that gets me to my own biography with the question that you asked me. I was born and raised in the Bronx. We lived in an area of the Bronx called the East Bronx near Southern Boulevard, which is about two and a half blocks from Bronx Park. That is the Bronx Zoo part of the Bronx Park. I went to public school in PS 57 on Crotona Avenue and 180th Street in the Bronx. I went to junior high school 118, which is on Arthur Avenue in the Bronx, which was part of an Italian neighborhood, and our neighborhood was Italian and Jewish and Irish, people of Irish background. I then took the test, and my mother said, "Why'd you take the test? You don't want to be a musician." I took the test for Music and Art High School, which is the predecessor of current LaGuardia High School in New York, and I got in. And I spent 4 years in Music and Art High School, where I learned almost nothing except music. Well, that was important because the academic program, in my judgment, was mediocre, like most high schools in New York. Their academic programs are mediocre. And then I barely got admitted to Brooklyn College. I went to Brooklyn College from the Bronx for a semester, and a half, and during that period, I became politically active against the college administration's ban of a left-wing organization called the Labor Youth League, and I signed a petition calling on students to demonstrate in front of the dean's office because they had banned the Labor Youth League and the newspaper that defended the student newspaper that defended the Labor Youth League. So we demonstrated 400 people, and I was suspended for conduct unbecoming a student.
Oh, boy.
And then I decided that because I was suspended for conduct unbecoming a student, and I felt that the administration was authoritarian, that there's no reason for me to go back. So 15 years between the time when I got suspended to the time when I went back and I got my degree at the new school, which I'll tell you about in a minute, I worked in factories. I worked in mostly the steel industry in New Jersey. Well, it wasn't Newark, it was Harrison, New Jersey, which was in Hudson County, where most of the industry in that area was built. It was right on the corner. It was right on the border of Newark.
Yeah.
I worked in a wire factory. That is to say, it made wire and it made sheet alloys, chromium and steel alloys. And I worked there, and I worked at Worthington Pump, which was in Harrison, as a machine operator as well, and spent about, I would say, roughly 8 years as a factory worker. Meanwhile, I got married and had two children. We lived in Newark in various apartments, and the thing that was characteristic of that time was that rents were cheap. And so even though we were poor, I mean literally poor, we didn't, you know, it was not a, until at the end of my factory life, we were pretty marginal as far as income was concerned. We still could survive. You know, I had to have a car because in that area you had to have a car, Essex County. It was very difficult to move around by public transportation. Then something happened to me, which was, and I was active in the union, and I was active in the neighborhood. And we built an organization called the Clinton Hill Neighborhood Council in the city of Newark. I was vice chair for organizing, actually, and we organized block clubs in every street of the community on issues like education, on issues like housing, on issues like urban removal. We called it urban removal, although the city called it urban renewal. They wanted to clear a large part of the neighborhood for light factory development, and we opposed it. We also were very active in improving the transportation. And the reason that it was an important moment is because this was a moment where an older Jewish community was rapidly becoming black, and secondarily Latino. And we tried to pull together the older residents with the newer residents. And we built block clubs, which were genuinely interracial for a while, until the tide turned so decisively that a lot of the white people left, you know. And we stayed. I mean, that is to say, we were not the only white people who stayed, but we became a distinctly white minority. And the coalition that we built in the Clinton Hill Neighborhood Council was interesting because it was of a Methodist church, the Trinity Methodist Church, which was a part of an urban church movement of the Methodist Church nationally. A local professor named Stanley Winters. And myself, we were three of us, and then other people in the community, and we actually were able to register a lot of successes in our fight to preserve the neighborhood from people removal and from gross deterioration of the educational and of the housing situation. And code enforcement, we fought on those issues. We actually ran one of our members, Winters, ran for city council. He didn't win, but he was very influential in trying to hold the line. The other part of my activity at that point was my union activity, and I was active in the shop, that is to say, in the plant. I was on the I was on the committee, shop steward for a while, and things like that. Then something important happened, which was that I got laid off, and we had a program of supplementary unemployment benefits, which had been initiated by the auto workers. The steel workers carried that out, and that meant that I didn't live on simply unemployment benefits. I was supplemented by the company, and that supplementary unemployment benefits plus the unemployment benefits from the city of from the state of New Jersey gave me about 80-85% of my salary, of my income. So I was able to survive, and in the meantime, I took advantage of an opportunity to become a student at the International Ladies Garment Workers Union's Training Institute. They wanted this was in preparation to become a union organizer. And I went through that for a year on the supplementary benefit plus the unemployment benefits, and I came out deciding not to work for the ILGWU because it was not a democratic union, in my opinion, not even in comparison to our steelworkers local. And so I worked for a while for the textile workers, and then I was made an offer by the Amalgamated Clothing Workers to run a national campaign, a permanent national campaign, of boycotts and of organizing. And I took that job, and it was the first living wage that I ever made. I mean, you know, it was, and so I became a union organizer, actually a head organizer for a group of people who were much older than me. I was in my 20s when I took that job, you know. And I became an organizer. I traveled all over the country. I traveled to the South, and I traveled to Pennsylvania, and I traveled to Ohio and places like that. And then in 1964, rather than continuing work with the clothing workers, which I felt also shared some of the undemocratic practices of the ILGW, the Ladies Garment Workers Union, I took a job as an organizer for the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic Workers International Union, and I worked there for 3 years, from 1964 to 1967. But in the meantime, John, there's always a meantime.
Okay.
I moved to New York, uh-huh. split with my wife, uh-huh. saw my kids on a weekly basis, but split with my wife. And in the meantime, I became active in the anti-war movement, uh-huh. you know, and also became an informal advisor, although I was only 4 or 5 years older than them, for the Students for Democratic Society. And those combined activities got my notice from the FBI and from the who had already knew who I was, FBI and I guess the CIA, because at some point while working for the OCAW, the Oil and Chemical Workers, they contacted the national organization, and there was an executive vice president for chemicals whose name was Elwood Swisher, mm-hmm. who we were convinced. I'll tell you who the we is in a minute.
Okay.
We were convinced was, if not on the FBI's payroll, was very close connected to them. And they wanted to fire me. Not the president of the union. He was a good guy. He was an oil worker from Port Arthur, Texas. But it wasn't him. It was this guy. And they wrote a guy named Victor Reisel, who was a columnist, national syndicated columnist, wrote a column naming me as the leader of the communist conspiracy in the labor movement. Yeah, which, by the way, wasn't true.
Okay.
But at the same right. time, that increased uh-huh. my pressure on me, obviously. And so the president, instead of firing me, uh-huh. he wouldn't fire me, because he was a principal guy. sent me to Puerto Rico. And I organized in Puerto Rico for a year, you know. But I had left my kids in New Jersey, and they were young. And at some point, I decided to take a leave of absence, because my kids were very disappointed in my absence, because I couldn't come home more than once a month, and sometimes not even that often. And I did a considerable amount of organizing in Puerto Rico. I organized in the chemical industry primarily, and I was a representative for an oil refinery, which was called the Commonwealth Oil Refinery. And I had an important experience there, but it was still very, there was a lot of pressure from home. So I went home and I took a leave of absence, worked for the city of New York, as a bureaucrat for a couple of years. Then I became the associate director of Mobilization for Youth, which was a youth work agency on the Lower East Side of New York, which is now called, most of it is called the East Village. I still call it the Lower East Side, which was primarily a Puerto Rican neighborhood at that time. And as associate director, we had one of the largest budgets of any anti-poverty agency of that period. You know, this is 1968-69, and we fought against the Lower Manhattan Expressway. And one of the things that my Newark experience had prepared me for, mm-hmm. was how to fight on urban renewal issues. And so I was able to help and participate in the in that activity, which was a coalition of Lower East Side people and people from Little Italy, which was south of Houston, mostly, and the West Village, which are largely artists. The three distinct constituents were fighting against an institution which David Rockefeller, Nelson Rockefeller's brother, called the Lower Manhattan Expressway. It would have cleared 20,000 apartments and innumerable buildings from an area that would begin with the Williamsburg Bridge. It would be it would have created an six or eight lane highway on Delancey Street. Think about it. I mean, it's just incredible.
So you helped stop that with Jane Jacobs too?
Yeah, Jane Jacobs was part of it. Okay. That's right. And a woman named Rochelle Wall, she was part of it. And we worked with the people from the South Village as well. And the people in the South Village not only included active neighborhood residents connected to the Catholic Church there. That was one of group. The others were some people in the mob. Well, they would have been significantly affected, you know. So we created a coalition. Our group was called the Lower East Side Committee Coalition for Human Housing, and theirs, and they had, you know, church based organizations and West Village organizations. Many of them were artists, and we won.
Stanley, I want to give you the whole hour here, but all this is background and knowledge, and I think this needs to also come out. But what amazes me is while you're doing all this activist work and all that's going on, somehow you manage to grow as an intellectual. And how did that process work? A lot of people watching us, for example, you know, people are business majors today because they feel like they have to make a living. And there's deficiencies in our education, including myself. People feel like they wish they could learn more, they could know. How did you manage, you're working in factories, you're organizing, how did you manage to have a schedule to actually read and develop as a writer and a reader?
With difficulty. I had two kids, I had work, but I continued to read, you know. That was something that, part of it was in the late night, you know, I would read, and the other was when I was on organizing trips, I would read in the motel room. And when I worked in Puerto Rico, I read all the time, because a lot of my work was at 6 o'clock in the morning or at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and it was for specific time slots. And so I was able to read in between. And it became habitual for me, but it wasn't just habitual. When I was an organizer, it was habitual, even when I was a factory worker and when I was in high school, to read all the time. You know, that was part of my home life, and it was also part of my training. And I didn't start really to write until I left union organizing. And that was, my first real writing was in 1969, 70. I wrote my first article that was published in 1970, a second article in 71. And in 1971, I began work on a book that became False Promises, my first book. And it was a very successful in terms of sales, and it had critical reception that was quite favorable. And at that point, I had already taken a job as an assistant professor after I worked at Park East High School, where I established that high school with other people, from 1970 to 72. In 1972, I took a job at Staten Island Community College, which is now part of the College of Staten Island. And it was during that period that I began writing this book called False Promises, whose subtitle was The Shaping of American Working Class Consciousness. And it was about the cultural as well as the political and labor union life of working people in the United States. And it's a 456-page book, which is still in print.
And this got the attention of some of the big intellectuals at the time,
yeah,
like Hannah Arendt and Herbert Marcuse.
That's correct.
That's right. A little bit about that.
The publisher, McGraw-Hill, the editor at McGraw-Hill, Joyce Johnson, said, do you know anybody who's famous who could endorse this book? And I knew Robert McCatchman, who was an economist, and I knew Noam Chomsky because I had been involved with Noam Chomsky in the anti-war movement. And I did not know Herbert Marcuse, but I was an admirer of Herbert Marcuse. So we sent copies of the page proofs to Marcuse, to Chomsky, to Lukacman, and they all came through with endorsements. In the case of Marcuse, however, he wrote a telegram to me and to the press, to McGraw-Hill, that said that I had broken through the ritualistic sociological categories, you know, and had established some new kinds of thinking about workers and about labor. And shortly thereafter, he invited me to come out to speak in California. He was in San Diego. He was about to be retired at the age of 70. He was born in 1898. And in 1972, they wanted to retire him. This book came out in 73, but he had gotten a year extension, so he still was on campus. And he invited me to come out, and I gave a series of talks in California, and we became friends. And it was then that I came to the attention of some of the people who taught at San Diego and taught at Irvine in the University of California. I was invited to be later on in the winter of 2006. See, this was 74 that I got invited out. In the winter of 2006, I became a visiting professor at the University of California of San Diego's comparative literature literature department at the invitation of Frederick Jameson.
One of the great postmodern theorists.
I was invited in the middle of that time. I was invited to be a visitor at the University of California at Irvine in the history department for a year. Meanwhile, I had to quit Staten Island in order to take those responsibilities. And I also had an invitation, which I took during that period. That was to say, during the spring of 1976, I took an invitation because San Diego had a quarter system. I was finished by March. And I took an invitation to teach at University of Paris, at Paris 8. And I taught there. When I came back in September of 76, I started teaching for a year in history at Irvine. In the middle of that, I was invited to become a full professor in the social science school at the University of California, Irvine. From teaching community college to a full professor in a major university.
Were you in Paris during the revolution, during the May uprising?
No. That was 68. No. But in 76, people still remembered 68.
Right.
They still remembered it. And I remember once going to somebody's dinner party, and on the mantle in his apartment was a brick, a cobblestone. And I said, what's the cobblestone about? He says, that's the cobblestone that I threw at the police in 1968, But something else happened in Paris, which was fascinating to me. I was pretty much convinced that because Nixon had become discredited and the Republican Party was completely discredited by the Watergate scandal, that the Democrats were going to win in 76. Not only was I convinced that they would win, but they would have to run an outsider, somebody who could present himself as an outsider to Washington. And I said, Jimmy Carter will be the candidate. I wrote three pieces for Le Monde Diplomatique, which is a monthly publication of the group that's called Le Monde, which is a major daily newspaper of France. I wrote three pieces on the American presidential election that were considered to be controversial, if not scandalous, by the French intellectual public. Why? Because Jimmy Carter was a peanut farmer. how can a peanut farmer be the president of the United States, they asked. And I said, because he's an outsider and because he was being supported by the Trilateral Commission. And I said, also, he was had been a governor of the state of Georgia. He was, a presentable figure who was not a Washington insider. And he was the one that they had selected. Anyway, I went around to almost every institution in Paris that made any sense at all from the point of view of public opinion, giving talks about this question and getting sharply both attacked and questioned by the professoriate and some of the administrators of in political theory, political science, et cetera, and politics. And it became in many ways my introduction to Paris and to France. I learned a lot, right? I mean, you know, it wasn't just that I was teaching. I went everywhere. So I came back.
The cultural growth.
That's right. I came back and then I started to work in California, and I worked in at Irvine from 1976, from the fall of 1976 through 1979. And then I got asked to be a visiting professor at the university called Columbia University back in New York. And I wanted to come back to New York. So I came back to New York. And in that period of 79 to 81, I spent 2 years there. I had to resign again from Irvine because I had taken time off from Paris, and 2 years was their limit. And since I decided to come back to New York, I resigned without a job. And I know that's not what people do, that not that adventurous. But I figured if I wanted to come back to New York, I didn't want to go back. I had to go back for one semester in 81. But after that, in 82, I got a visiting gig at City College. And the reason I got a visiting gig at City College is because I established with union people, especially Teamsters, municipal employees local, I established the Center for Worker Education. And so we established a center, which was a bachelor's degree program for working adults. And I got appointed there in 82. And then in 83, they appointed me a full professor at both the Graduate Center and at City College. I had a dual appointment. And I was there from 83 on. And since then, I've been at CUNY. In 87, I left the Center for Worker Education because I was doing two full-time jobs, and I went to the Graduate Center full-time. But I still taught sometimes in the colleges. I still do. So anyway, that's my short biography.
I want to say how inspiring you are, Stanley, to me and to many others. The fact that you were able to take control of your life in that way, your intellectual growth, despite having to work, you know, a working job that took up a lot of your time, and despite the activism, you sort of shaped your own destiny. You created your own narrative, and I think that's a great example. And now you go around the country and you give lectures. You're a wonderful speaker. You wake people up to what's really needs to happen in terms of the political situation. What advice would you give people out there that are feeling hopeless? Because as we know, a lot of the way people feel in everyday life is often connected to the politics of our country. This is something that C. Wright Mills talked about, and you were an admirer of Mills. What hope could you give people for, you know, you think Occupy Wall Street's really going to change things? And as far as the educational front, what needs to be done so people can actually learn stuff?
I'm very hopeful, not that Occupy Wall Street itself will change things, but it is a symptom of the reawakening of a whole generation which had been basically given up on by a lot of intellectuals and a lot of journalists. This movement called Occupy is electrifying, still electrifying a lot of young people and electrifying a lot of people generally. But see, one of the problems that still exists, and it's not a small potato, is that we still don't have a movement of ideas. We know that there's terrible inequality. We know that there's terrible discrimination still. And we know that there's growing resistance and growing protest in this country. But what we still lack, and we're not going to get this anytime real soon, What we still lack is a conception of what a good life would be. What would it be like to get rid of the kind of inequality we have? How would we do that? Well, one of the ways to do that is to create at least some educational institutions, whether they be public or private, that really try to promote in young people critical thinking and try to give them a sense of the world in which they live and try to get them away from this idea that education is all about jobs. The point is, and this is a terrible thing to say to people who hear me, that in the United States, there are no jobs. I mean, there are, you know, a job here and a job there, and, you know, but basically there's no real prospects of mass employment, especially mass employment that will be of a socially mobile kind, which means that people who are factory workers, family, can become lawyers and doctors and engineers and computer experts. They've overproduced everything except doctors. They haven't overproduced doctors. In fact, they've underproduced doctors, and the reason is because they don't have enough medical schools that are accredited, and the medical schools are keeping the supply of doctors down so they can keep the rates up. You know, this is really true. We now have more lawyers than we can accommodate. The engineers are still being able to get jobs, get work, but not in every field of engineering either. The computer engineer is not somebody who necessarily gets an easy job. We are in a situation where the number of jobs available for college graduates and for even postgraduate people is diminishing very radically.
You have to majoring in business. That's
well, that's silly.
What does that mean?
It's absolutely silly. Okay. I mean, I'm not saying people shouldn't try to go into small businesses or maybe make some money. That's not the point I'm making. Yeah. But you don't need a degree in business to be able to go into business, you know. You better to spend your time, this valuable time between the ages of 18 and 25, let's say, learning stuff. Being really critical, being able to grab the world, being able to go with your heart as to what you really want to learn and what you really want to do.
And who are some of the writers who you think are important to read? Or are some of the authors that have affected you? And who should people read? Like you said, the classics.
Well,
I
like a lot of Shakespeare. Yeah, I like Richard III, and you know, one can read Hamlet with profit. But I'm not talking only about Shakespeare. I'm talking about even more contemporary writers. Contemporary meaning 20th century writers. The poet William Butler Yeats. The poetry of Pablo Neruda. The poetry of T.S. Eliot, who was a pessimistic poet, but has a lot of juice, you know.
And what about Karl Marx?
Karl Marx, obviously. I mean,
yes.
Ezra Pound.
Ezra Pound.
Fascist as he was, pro-Mussolini as he was, he was a wonderful poet. Okay. I mean, the point is that one of the things you get out of writing. One of the things you get, and Salman Rushdie, some of his novels are very good too. Midnight's Children, I particularly like, is you get a sense of the language. You become articulate. You become adroit at being able to express yourself because you have had constant reading and all that stuff. But we have contemporary. I mean, Karl Marx obviously is an important radical commentator on both political economy and on world politics. Mm-hmm. But of the more contemporary people, there's Gramsci. Mm. Antonio Gramsci is very accessible, you know, and you could read Gramsci with great profit. There's a book of selections of his work. There are two books of selections. People can read his work, Selections from the Prison Notebooks, it's called. And he was an Italian. He was Italian communist with a very broad outlook. Rosa Luxemburg is another person that I learned a lot from, and George Lukacs, Lukacs.
These Hungarian.
He's Hungarian, but he was Hungarian who wrote a lot in German, and most of his stuff now is translated, not all of it, but most of his stuff is translated into English, and the most important of his books that's translated is called History and Class Consciousness, okay. where he talks about the problem of class consciousness. And of the English-speaking writers, E.P. Thompson, The Making of the English Working Class, is a very great book.
Okay. Paulo Freire?
Paulo Freire's, sure, Pedagogy of the Oppressed and Pedagogy of the of Freedom. Yes.
And we're almost at, I just wanted to say, and again, this is like top 10 recommendations from Stanley. Must read this books. We have about 4 minutes left, and I'm reading Dickens' Tale of Two Cities now. So I was very happy when you opened the Left Forum, when you gave the opening speech, and you said, these are the best of times, and these are the worst of times. Closing thoughts, we have a few minutes left, Stanley, in terms of people's hopes. What do you advise in terms of moving forward with the political situation, and your final thoughts on today's discussion?
Well, the first thing to do is to get active, and the second thing, which is not second in line, but two things on equal, is read, and read critical stuff, read novels, read poetry. Become, in some sense, hopeful, because you see people who live in times of despair actually succeed in rejuvenating reawakening consciousness. Now, if you are around an Occupy Wall Street site, not just in New York, but in other parts of the country or other parts of the world, you could join that site. If you're in a factory or you're in a office, organize into a union. Not to say that the unions have all the answers; they have very few answers. But at the very least, they provide some degree of organized protest and organized resistance to the continued race to the bottom that America's large corporations are promoting. And I think you have to be part of that. And secondly, I think it's very, very important to read the daily newspaper, and not to be so discouraged by the news that you forget that there are things going on that, you know, can be inspirational. You know, now I think today's broadcast is only a beginning. I hope that I can see some of the others, people that you talk to.
Okay.
And I was very impressed by the quality of your questions. They were very much on the mark. Okay.
Thank you so much for spending time with us today, Stanley.
Okay.
Thank you. Hope you enjoyed our talk with Stanley Aronowitz, one of the most profound public intellectuals and activists of our time. We're back now in Hoboken in my apartment, and as you can see, my bookshelf behind me, not quite as big as Stanley's yet, but I'm working on it. And this has been a wonderful experience, and Stanley has that ability to inspire and transform the people around him. He just, you know, he's a natural born teacher and leader in that way. And moving forward from this event, a couple things I want to say. One, in terms of the educational crisis, I have begun to create educational events that are in the form of parties. Okay? Basically, they're cultural gatherings. I created a project called the Evolved Urbanite, which brings together culture, urban living, and community, to build a sense of community through talking about the arts and ideas and giving little mini lectures, but in a social dynamic. So that's one thing I'd like to do to address this situation. And the other political arm, I think, that needs to happen is to build up an alternative to the Democrats and Republicans, who are both controlled by the same corporations that are not very interested in democracy, as we can see, but interested in advancing the 1% profit margin of the people in charge. So I think one possibility could be building up the Green Party, including here in Hoboken and Hudson County, where I live. So that's another thing I'd like to work on. And we hope that Stanley will come back and be an advisor to us on the show, on this project, as we move forward. And, you know, we can't give up hope. We have to move forward. And Stanley named some of the problems, and now we have to go out and try to fix them. Okay? Thank you for watching the Public Voice Salon, and we'll see you next time.